Hi, and welcome to the first part of a mini-series to create a super simple character controller in Unity using the not-so-new input system. In this series, we will be creating a simple character controller you can modify and use for both first and third-person games. We will be going through how to move and rotate your character, jumping and applying gravity and so on. In this part, we will be setting up the input system. So, if you haven't already, head over to Window and choose Package Manager and make sure you have Unity Registry selected in the Packages selection up here. From here, you can either scroll down to find it or just search for input system. Click on install and let Unity restart once the installation is done. Now, there are plenty of different ways to implement and use the input system. My preferred way is to use an event manager, or you could have your own custom player input class, but I believe this to be a more beginner-friendly way. And this way you won't be dependent on an event manager and you can easily move this character controller to another project of yours. What we will start with today is to create an empty game object by right-clicking in the hierarchy and choosing Create Empty. Let's just call this Player Input. Now, add a Player Input component to it. You have a Create Actions button here that will automatically create quite a few actions that you may or may not need. Let me just show you what it looks like. You don't need to follow along. Since we won't be needing most of these just yet, I'll just go ahead and delete this file. I will, however, leave the player input component on the player input object, because we will be using that. So go ahead and add the component to your player input object if you didn't already do that. So, now that we have the input system already, we can go ahead and create a folder for our input related things. I'll just create one here in the assets folder and call it input. Inside of your input folder, right click and choose create, and then input actions down in the bottom. For clarity, I'll just call mine player input. Go ahead and drag your new input actions to the player input components action field and double click the input actions asset to open up the editor. Let's start by creating a new action map. I'll call it gameplay, since we will be using it for gameplay related actions such as movement and camera rotation. You will probably have other action maps for other things eventually, such as UI, but gameplay is all we need for now. Under actions, you'll find new action. Go ahead and rename that one to move. I will remove the binding and for the action type I'll choose value and the control type will be a vector2. This means that we will be passing a vector2 value, so W on your keyboard will give us a positive Y value while S gives us a negative. The same way A gives us a negative X value and D gives us a positive. The Y value will later be used as a Z value for the character, so we will be moving forward and backwards, not up and down. Under actions, click the plus sign next to your move action and choose add up, down, left, right composite. Name your 2D vector WASD. Start by clicking on the up option and have a look at path under binding. Now, you could go down to keyboard and find W under there, but just click on listen up here and tap W on your keyboard. This will assign W as your up key. Repeat the same thing for the rest of the keys, S for down, A for left, and D for right. Don't forget to save your inputs up here, the Save Asset button. You could also set it to autosave up here to the right. Let's look at your player input object again. Make sure player input is selected under actions. You can just ignore these for now, so let's look at behavior. You have a few options for the behavior, where send message triggers these functions within any script attached to the object. Broadcast messages does basically the same, but includes any and all child objects. We'll be looking at the events, and using Unity events. You have a few predefined events here, for when the controller gets disconnected or changed, but looking at the gameplay, you'll now find your move event. So let's create a player controller class. I don't have a scripts folder yet, so I'll start by creating one here under assets. Inside of your scripts folder, right-click and create a new C# class called Player Controller. I will be using a simple capsule for my character, but if you already have a character you'd like to use, feel free to. And with your character selected, click on Add Component and choose your Player Controller script. Open up the player controller script and let's clean this up a bit by removing the start and the update method for now, and just add a simple function called move. Let's quickly add a simple debug log to make sure everything is working. Jump back into Unity, and under Events and Gameplay in the Player Input component, click on the plus sign from the Move event. Drag your character with the player controller script attached to it to the object field here. And then we just have to choose player controller and the move function. Let's hit play, and as expected, we can now see the message player moving in the console when we use any of the keys assigned to movement. To get the actual value, we can open up our script again and take in a callback context as a parameter. Include the input system by typing using unityEngine.inputSystem in the top here. Now, within the parentheses of our function, type inputAction.callbackContext followed by context. To get the value out of context here, we can create a simple variable to keep it clear. We will be using this later on, so let's create a new private variable of type vector2 and call it input. Now, in the move method, type input equals context.readValue, which gets the value we're passing, a vector2 that we put in angle brackets and finish up with opening and closing parentheses. And then just a quick debug log again to make sure everything is working. Back in Unity, before hitting play, have a look at the events again. It will probably say that the move function is missing. Click it, choose player controller and look at the top, where you'll now find your move function under dynamic callback context. Let's run this again. Looking at the console, you can now see a vector2 value. Pressing D gives us 1 on the x-axis, while pressing A gives us a negative 1. Pressing W gives us 1 on the y-axis, while S gives us a negative 1. Letting go of the keys returns the value back to 0, 0. We will put this to use in the next episode where we'll make our character actually move. And that's it for setting up the input system. In the next episode, we will start looking into actually moving your character. With all this preparation, you're actually halfway there. I will post this project on GitHub, to which you'll find a link in the description. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.